OpenAI just released the Responses API, which promises to streamline the development process of AI agents. In fact, the Responses API will be replacing both the Completions and the Assistance API in the near future, so you definitely don't want to be left behind. According to the API documentation, this is the most advanced interface for generating model responses. This API supports both text and image inputs and text outputs. This is really important to understand. When the Completions API was initially released back in 2023, model interactions were really simple. It was text in and text out. Since then, multimodal models came into existence, and we're now able to pass things like images to the model as well. AI agents with tool use also became prevalent since then as well, and this API provides several built-in tools like file search, web search, and computer use. It also simplifies the process of dealing with conversation history through stateful interactions. In this series, you will learn everything you need to know about using this new Responses API. We will look at the basics by setting up the SDK in a Python environment, and we'll send messages to both chat models and reasoning models. We will also have a look at the multimodal support by chatting with images. We will also have a look at the new way of dealing with conversation history through stateful interactions. You will learn how to work with structured output. You will also learn how to use the built-in tools offered by the SDK, and you will also learn how to add your own functions as tools to your agents as well. Then finally, we'll give our agent full access over our browser using the computer use tool. I will leave a link to all of the documentation referenced throughout the series in the description of these videos. You will find a link to the source code on GitHub as well. And finally, this is the Python version of this tutorial, and I will be releasing a JavaScript or TypeScript version in the near future. You will also need an OpenAI API key. If you don't have one yet, go to platform.openai.com/API keys. Do take note that OpenAI is a paid service, so you do have to load some credit onto your account. After that, create a new secret key, and let's call it Responses API Tutorial. Let's create this key, then copy the key, and in your code editor, simply open up a new folder. Within this folder, create a new file and call it .env. And let's give this variable a name, like OpenAI API key, and simply paste in that API key. So I'm going to close this .env file, as we no longer have to add anything to it. And all we have to do now is set up our Python environment. You can do this however you want. I prefer to simply run Python-m, venv, and venv again. Then we can simply activate this virtual environment. So on Windows, you can simply refer to venv, scripts, and activate. If you're using Mac or Linux, it would be something like source, then venv/bin/activate. When your virtual environment is active, you should see this prefix at the start of this command. Let's start by installing a few dependencies. Let's run pip install OpenAI, and in order to use our environment variable, let's also install python -.env. And let's press enter to install both of these dependencies. And finally, let's create a new file and let's call this lesson-1.py. Now let's have a look at how we can use this Responses API in our code. Let's start by importing from OpenAI. Let's import the OpenAI class. Now let's create an instance of this OpenAI class. I'll just call this variable client, and let's assign it to OpenAI, like so. Now we can start passing messages to this OpenAI client. This is really simple. All we have to do is type client, and previously you would call this completions object, but now we need to call the responses object instead. And on this object, we have a method called create. This method takes in a few parameters. First is the model name. For this example, and to keep the costs low, let's call GPT-40-mini. And then we can add another parameter called input. And in here, we can write a message like, hello, how are you? We will have a look at more parameters in a second, but let's see if this is working. Let's assign this to a response variable. And finally, let's print that response. like so. Now in the terminal, let's run the script by writing py and let's call lesson one. Right, we now get this error saying that we did not pass in the API key. So there are two ways to pass in this API key. Either we can pass it as a parameter, or we can set it as an environment variable, which is what we did. We just didn't make the environment variable available to this code. And this was intentional, as I do want to show you both ways. Sometimes you might want to swap out the API key on the fly. So what you could do is when you're instantiating the client, you could pass in the API key at this point. So we could just copy this key from the environment variable. So I'll just grab it from here and then use that when instantiating this class. Now, if we run this again in the terminal, we do get a successful response back. So we get this response object back, which includes a lot of data, like the response ID, when a message was created, the token usage, as well as the text output. If we only wanted the text output, we could make this change by saying response dot, and from this list, let's add output and text. In the terminal, let's run this again, and now we only get the text back. So this parameter solution might be practical if you're building an application where you need to dynamically swap out the API key. For instance, maybe you've built some application where the user can bring their own key, so you're simply retrieving the user's key from the database and dynamically injecting it into this client. Of course, a more secure way of doing this is to add your API key to your environment variables and then let OpenAI automatically check your environment variables for that key. So all we have to do is pull in the environment variable file, which we can do by calling from.env import load.env. And all we have to do then is call load.env with parentheses. And if we run this in the terminal, we do get a response back. Awesome. Now let's have a deeper look at this create method. We can add a lot more properties to this, like the maximum amount of tokens that should be allowed. We can also add an instructions property, and this is actually the system prompt that we can pass to our model. We can use this to affect the behavior and rules of this model. For example, let's say I want this model to respond like a pirate. So let's just say respond like a pirate. And if we run this in the terminal, our assistant is indeed responding like a pirate. Cool, you can also set all sorts of other things in the system prompt, like how and when to use tools, and what it should and should not do. So this is quite an important property. We can also do a lot more with the input parameter. Instead of passing in a single piece of text, we can pass in a list instead. So what I like to do is to create a new variable called input messages, and this is a list, and within this list we can have different dictionary items. So we can simply add a dictionary, and for the first key we could set the role, and this could be user, which represents the user message, or we could even pass in an assistant or the AI message, which is called assistant. And I believe there is another role called developer as well, which acts like the instructions property down here, but this will be passed along with each and every message, where the instructions property is only passed once and at the start of the conversation. So let's switch this back to user. And for the second key, we need to provide the content. This could also be a single value. So we could simply grab our input down here, pass it into this. Or alternatively, what we could do is pass in an array of content values as well. And we will have a look at this during the course of this tutorial. But what this effectively means is you might have one message that contains the text, like describe this image. And the second content item might be a link to the actual image. But like I said, we will have a look at that during the course of this tutorial. For now, let's simply pass in text. So now we can replace this input string with our input messages instead. And if we run this in the terminal, and there we go, we still get the message back. For fun, let's actually add another message. So let's say from the user, we said the password is responses API. Then let's pretend the assistant came back to us. So we'll just add another message called assistant, and then let's pretend the agent said, got it. And then finally, let's say the user then asked, what is the password? Question mark. Now, if we run this in the terminal, the agent should be able to provide us with that password, which it does. And look, this is a very old school way of building up a conversation history, and I will show you the new way of dealing with conversation state in the stateful interactions video in this series. For now, just know that it is possible to pass multiple messages, so let's actually just revert this back to something like, why is the sky blue? Cool. One other parameter that you might want to use in your applications is to stream the responses instead of just outputting it in one go. So in the create method, we can simply add a property called stream, and let's set this to true. This method will actually stream the response back to us chunk by chunk. So what we can do is say with streaming, I'm going to create a new variable called full response, which is equal to an empty string initially. Then let's say for event in response. So event will give us all those chunks as they're streaming in. And let's have a look at what this event actually looks like. Let's run this in the terminal. And here we can see a lot of different objects streaming in. So I'm just going to open this up so we can see what we actually received. So let's go all the way back to the top. And here we can see we are receiving this response created events, which gives us some response ID along with the system instructions and all of that. But what we are interested in is the type of this response. This response is of type response created, which is just the initial message that we passed along to the agent. The next object is this response in progress event object, and this has a type of response in progress. So not quite what we're looking for. Then the next one is saying that this is a response.content part added. Not quite interested in that yet. And now we can see these objects coming through. Response text delta events. And in this delta property, we can actually see the chunks being streamed in. So because it's acting like a pirate, it's sort of saying R, and there's the rest of the R, comma, mate, etc. We can identify these objects by the type, which is response.output underscore text dot delta. And we can see that's a type for all of these different objects. So in our loop, we could look at these types only. And if the event contains this type, we simply want to output the delta value, which is the text value. So let's do that. Let's say that if the event dot type is equal to, and I'm going to copy this text, so it's response dot output underscore text dot delta. If that is the event type, then we simply want to print event.delta. So that's this text over here. Right, let's save this file, and in the terminal, I'm actually going to expand this, and let's see what happens. Right, so we can see the response streaming in, but it's writing each chunk in its own line. To write all of this on a single line, to make it look a bit more natural, we can go to our print statement and add end equals an empty string and flush equals true. So what we can do then is in the terminal, let's run this again. And that looks way better. Now you might be wondering why I created this full response variable. Well, usually what happens in these applications is you might want to stream the response as it's coming in. And when you receive the full response, you might want to do something with that full response in your application. So for completeness sake, I'll just say full response, and then let's append event.delta. And then outside of this loop, let's print full response and let's add full response, like so. Right, so let's run this again. Our input is streaming in, and we can see the full response being written here. So what we could do is add a \n\n, just to create some space. So I'll just simply run this again, and this should look way better. Cool, so the response streamed in, and finally we can see the full response coming back. Awesome. Now let's have a look at working with reasoning models. ChatGPT 4.0 is a chat model, but we can also swap this out with a reasoning model. And for the remainder of this course, I won't be streaming the responses, but it's really up to you which way you want to go. In order to use reasoning models, all we have to do is change the model to a reasoning model like O3 Mini. And for the input, I'm just going to say How much wood would a woodchuck chuck? And for reasoning models, you typically don't want to pass in any system instructions. The rule of thumb is you typically want to just tell the reasoning model what you want and then let it figure it out itself. I'm also going to remove the streaming property as we're no longer using that. And I'll just also make sure to comment out this line, and that should be good. And when using reasoning models, you can also specify the reasoning effort. So in our create method, let's pass in a property called reasoning, and this takes in a dictionary as input with a key of effort, which we can set to high, low, or medium. This will determine how long this will take and the amount of tokens that will be used. Let's just use medium for this demo. And optionally, you can also provide another property called generate summary. But this model currently does not work with O3 Mini, so I'm guessing it will be supported by reasoning models in the near future. Now let's go ahead and run this in the terminal. And after about 10 seconds, the model came back with this answer. Now that we know the basics of using this responses API, let's move on to working with images.